Nothing has so far been attempted on the waterworks at considerable expense. The English had constructed on Diana's Peak a huge reservoir from which water was brought by means of pipes to the camp in Longwood. At Longwood, it was collected into a reservoir constructed several feet in depth, whence it could be taken to all parts of the garden. The emperor planned to construct reservoirs joined up by uncovered pipes, and in great detail traced the plans on the ground. On the side of these, he was going to erect a huge aviary in the Chinese style. Out of the mold dug out for the reservoirs was made a round mound with grass steps and intended to be planted with flowers and rose trees. But this sort of amphitheater, being as high as the veranda, obstructed the view of the kitchen garden and impeded communication. The emperor had a kind of tunnel driven through this earth and constructed a sort of grotto with glass doors lined with painted wood and penetrated by a huge wooden guttering by means of which water was brought from the reservoir to the kitchen garden. He often went to sit down in this grotto. In the middle reservoir, Chandelier, the cook, had succeeded by means of a lead pipe in erecting a little fountain, which only played when the emperor went out. And this was a substitute for his elaborate fountains at St. Cloud, Versailles, and the Tuileries. Compared to these little spring was ridiculous, but these people had done their best and set their wits to work, hoping to entertain him, but not knowing how to please him. It was the work of lowly, humble folk. They were proud because their master appeared gratified, and because whoever could find some pretext went to see the work of the Frenchman, the doings at Longwood being the sole topic of conversation throughout the whole island. And so, by an astonishing indiscretion, Miss Johnson, Lowe's stepdaughter, boldly entered the garden where she met Montsalon and told him she had come to see Longwood and very much desired to meet the emperor. She was very pretty, and Montsalon offered his arm, took her everywhere, and finally introduced her to the emperor, who was strolling beneath a long covered walk overrun with passion flowers, of which he was very fond. The emperor was charmed with this young creature, made a few polite remarks to her, had sweets offered to her, and with his own hand plucked a rose, which he offered the girl. It was not only in the gardens that the emperor's servants busied themselves. If he was simple in his taste, the emperor experienced the physical abhorrence of dirty curtains and carpets. This was the case in both his bedrooms, where the Nankin curtains were covered with damp from the walls and the carpet had been gnawed by rats. Several remedies were suggested to him, but he refused to allow English workmen to enter his interior apartments and only decided to permit a change upon Marchand, assuring him that all the work would be done by people, the household cleaning and papering the walls, repairing the window frames, the substitution of muslin for the Nankin curtains, polishing and varnishing the furniture, whitewashing the ceilings. All this was carried out by his valets, assisted by some of the Chinese. The transparent muslin gathered top and bottom, filled in folds, and formed a pleasing corrugated effect, and narrow gathered frill of the same material hid the top hem of the curtain, while the bottom rested on the skirting board. These curtains, of which they had other similar, could be changed in 2 hours. New green silk draperies were put on the two little camp beds. The knobs of the bedposts were unscrewed, and in their place were substituted the eagles kept back when the silver had been broken up. The pictures were changed. Everyone taxed his ingenuity. The Grand Marshal sent a little polished brass timepiece and a bust of the infant king of Rome, which he put on the chimneypiece. When the emperor entered the room, two aromatic pastilles were burning in the scent box, and the flickering light from the cover flame pleasingly lit up the walls. "This is no longer a bedroom," he said. "This is a young lady's boudoir." Almost immediately, he had to occupy the second apartment. The emperor had a scene. Helena Marchand wrote to little camp beds. At night, he went from one to the others. He went from one room to the other several times. He told me that if he fell ill, these beds would be too narrow. Count Montsalon had a brass one, which he had bought in the town, and suggested that it be put in the second room. Green hangings were bought for this bed. I had lace and a large Alençon point on the emperor's dressing table, and procured a counterpane and lace pillowcases, for this bed was actually a state bed, a mirror 4 feet high and 3.5 wide, and 2 small bookcases completed the furnishing. The emperor appeared very satisfied, except that on going to bed, he said to Marchand, "I do not want Maussan to give up his bed. He must have it back." That night, as usual, he changed from bed to bed, beginning with the brass one and finding it most uncomfortable. "All this lace," he said to Marchand the next morning, "will be useful to the Grand Marshal's wife." And he substituted his second camp bed for a grand bed. These attentions pleased the emperor, to whom they provided a sort of pastime, just as he had supervised the furnishing of the Tuileries, Compiègne, and Fontainebleau with Fontaine and Dismasi, Duroc, and David. So he now paid his own servants in shillings as formerly he had in millions. He had certainly discharged his obligation to Montalon and to Gorgon, and there exists his maitre d'hotel, Pierron. Ledger with the increases entered in his own hand. There is also that of his valet Marchand, who was his treasurer, and who endeavored to economize on running expenses in order to increase the reserve fund by some 1,000 francs. He had formerly in this way, by curtailing household expenses, put aside the sum of 300 millions, with which during the campaigns in France he maintained the national defense. He was therefore equal to all demands, great or small. And his character was as stable as his habits. In this little community, habits and characters studied the more closely, and particular ways of acting and thinking are the more precisely noticed. The emperor admitted that the four great events of human life could not be fulfilled without the intervention of religion and priestly hope. He had requested a Catholic priest upon the death of Cipriani, so that he himself should not die like a dog. All the priests chosen by Fesch were stupid, but they were priests, and as such they could do for him what no other man knew how to do. That can only surprise those who, different in race, ancestry, and religion to Roman Catholics, judge these latter by their own standards. Napoleon never professed any disbelief and had an innate horror of atheism. "It is the disease to be feared," he said, and he fought it with not very convincing arguments. Incontestably deistical, he did not contradict the Catholic creed, and never did he in word or deed question its dogma. He had an exclusively Catholic atavism. There had been priests in both family lineages. His mother was very pious and had become religious. He had had a Catholic childhood and a Catholic education. Who knows the mysterious and secret bonds which bind a man to his ancestors' religion, to the religion his mother taught him, and of which he learned to babble the prayers as soon as he could talk? What held him to it may have been neither the knowledge nor the comprehension of the religion, nor even faith, but his very life and the life of all his family. This it was which aroused him when he entered certain churches, heard certain hymns, smelt certain odors. Here was the religion in which his ancestors had lived, in which he had been born and educated, a religion which revealed the existence of God and belief in the immortality of the soul, with its traditional worship, its liturgical splendor, its sacramental graces. He considered it the best and never doubted it. Since between it and the Protestant religion, which lying and seditious men had asserted he had forced upon the nation, he had chosen it, restored and assured the material lot of its priests. He had granted it, if not political privileges, at least civil distinctions and dispensations. He had striven to preserve it by his own lust from national danger, and had, by his constant attendance at Sunday Mass and by his devotion during service, testified to an observance which those lads disputed who were shocked at the idea of entering a church and participating in any traditional ritual at the moments necessary to give more effective proofs of his reliance in the Catholic Church. He never let it down. As certain incidents prove, the Abbés Bonavita Vignali had brought to St. Helena a trunk containing church ornaments and mass vestments of great beauty, and they said mass every Sunday upon a table in the drawing room. The emperor thought that the dining room, which he no longer used, could be converted to a chapel of a permanent nature, and that he would in future take his meals in the drawing room. Great care was taken to make the chapel worthy of the emperor, and all along with shared in the work of Arras, assisted by a Chinese carpenter, constructed an altar on two steps. Pierron, who was first in the art, made a most beautiful gold and white tabernacle for the Blessed Sacrament. Marchand and Saint-Denis draped the sides with red satin hangings, which reached from the ceiling and were drawn up by golden hooks, a green velvet carpet with a crown surmounted and in gold and smaller ends in the corners, covered the altar steps and reached to the Empress Puju. The trimmings lacked crowns, and the servants strenuously asserted that all the ends must bear their imperial decoration. Montalon very obtunely found in his trunks his dress jacket of aide-de-camp to the deputy commander-in-chief. The trimmings were there, and the four crowns besides. For the carpet, there was a large cross for the altar frontal wrapped up in a cloth decorated with old and valuable lace on each side of the tabernacle, which was surmounted by an ebony cross bearing a beautiful figure of Christ, were put six-branched silver candlesticks and china vases filled with the most beautiful flowers from the garden. At midday the following Sunday, for everything had been prepared secretly in the course of a single week, the only door by which the room could be lighted was carefully shut and the candles lighted. Lamps were placed on brackets on either side of the altar. Before it stood the Abbe Bonavita, attired in his most beautiful vestments, assisted by the Abbe Vignali and with young Bertrand as server. Behind the imperial chair, the little colony was arranged in order of precedence. The emperor entered, followed by the grand marshal and Montalon, and stood before his preacher, the Abbe Bonavita, bowed to him as the chaplain greeted him in the imperial chapels and began the mass. There were many joyful hearts in St. Helena that day, and from that little chapel where, in their simplicity, good, honest men had worked hard, went forth affectionate, unrestrained prayer for their country, as well as thanksgiving for the religion their ancestors had observed. And the emperor did not hesitate to play his part. He wanted to share in the beautifying of the chapel and gave lace to ornament the cloths and the alps, and presented the Abbe with fine linen alps. Every Sunday he attended the service, and when his health deteriorated, he heard mass from his bed with his bedroom door open, but he never missed it until his dying day.